Welcome you all at the next of the open lecture series organized by the Faculty of Architecture of the Estonian Academy of Arts. And it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's speakers. There's more than one, there's two, and there's also a special occasion for that. Bernhard, B.Sommer, Galo, G.Moncayo are here to open the new professorship of energy design in the Faculty of Architecture, which in turn is the first step of a hopefully long and fruitful collaboration of the Faculty of Architecture and the biggest Estonian building company, Mencom. Now, Bernhard Sommer is one of the founders of the energy design department together with Brian Curley in Vienna in the University of Applied Arts, and is also where he is currently also teaching and researching. He's also the founder and the head of Exicon, which is the office that specializes in the use of latest design technologies within the goal of early integration of scientific knowledge into the design process, which is more or less exactly what we are aiming with the energy design, also here in Thailand. Bernhard was trained as an architect and now working in the sort of very interdisciplinary field between engineering and architecture, and involving himself in a lot of research. Galo G.Moncayo is of a slightly different background, but they all come together in Vienna, in the Andelanten. Galo was trained as an artist, and he has a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Sculpture from the Maryland Institute College of Art in the US, and the Master of Fine Arts in Sculpture from Virginia Commonwealth University. After that, he also did the MA in Architecture in Vienna in the studio of Zaha Hadid. And this is where, in the Andelanten, where Galo is currently also teaching together with Bernhard in the Department of Energy Design. And he's also involved still in the production of art and architecture. Please join in welcoming Bernhard Sommer and Galo G.Moncayo.
Good evening, and thank you, Thomas, very much for the kind introduction. Thank you to the Estonian Academy for inviting us here. And also, Merkel, because it's not very good that they do that. Thomas, you mentioned Galo coming from a different background. It was a very, we came together very naturally. Galo, after finishing his study at the Fine Arts University, asked me if I would have a job for him. and I was surprised that he asked me. Yeah. But then we found that this is a very fruitful cooperation, and we started our cooperation first at the Hexagon office. We still do. Together competitions and projects, and we started to teach together. And I think one point is that technology-wise, if you look at the energy question, we are kind of stuck in the evolvement. You already have the super isolating building scheme, you already have very smart technologies to run the buildings. But there is a problem with integrating that into the built world. And I think only together with an artist's point of view we can manage that, because it's now more a cultural task than a technology task. That's at least what we are convinced of. And this conviction, this was shared last week. We got a big funding from the Austrian Research Agency for 1 year of heavy research into some of these projects I'll show you tonight. And we will build mock-ups, we will evaluate them, we will monitor them. So I think it's really an important moment for architects to start to think about these aspects more naturally. That's the game, and that's what we try to contribute at your academy. That to think with energy in mind is primarily and design, not in the foreground. It's something we have to have in the background. Yes, it is, and that's the question at the moment. Is time really on our side as climate, and especially also the society changes? We, at the moment, try to develop quite a bit highly optimized, customized feelings. And I mean, I'm doing that in my office all the time because I have to. Yeah, but what we do is we take a climate file. Best case, if we have a reasonable climate, we take one which already considers global warming to a certain extent. But of course, there's a lot of things we don't know. And then we customize these buildings towards this one function, or also in a better case, we can do it that we say you shouldn't build for one function, you should build for any function, but we still have to customize for that site, for that mind. And that can go terribly wrong. We can end up like that fish or like Salton City, which was designed as a resort near 2 hours from Los Angeles and was a big boom after the 1945. After 1945, there was a dam was broken and was flooding the plain there, and there was a huge lake, the Salton Sea, emerging. It's still there, and the people thought it's a nice opportunity. The real estate developers came, bought the cheap desert land, and started to build up the whole infrastructure for a fishing resort, a yacht resort. But they didn't think about how environment behaves. And actually, if you have a big lake, and then also the additional put fish there for the fishing resort, then it doesn't take so long that this lake dies. If you go there now, you have beaches covered with the bones of the fish, and it's a very bad smell. That's why it never took off. Yeah. While the setting process still was going on, the whole lake was collapsing and was rendered useless. So this is a nice example for a very straightforward design idea, which did end up disastrous. So what is this term optimization about? What is energy about? It's not that we never optimized before. Since the first building was an optimization, it was better than before. It was better than sleeping outside. And in many places, there is specific architecture evolved in the tropical climate. I showed that to students earlier before, but we have also new guests, so we go a bit deeper into this. And you see all the elements you would recommend for tropical building. Also nowadays, it's very well ventilated. You don't need, or even you want to avoid thermal mass, because the temperatures are always the same. There's no use in storing the cool of the night, because it's not cool. And it's no use of storing heat, because it's anyway too hot. So what you want is a light building, fully ventilated, you have a very steep sun. Yeah, so you need only short ventilated roofs. And the whole building is orientated east-west, so that you have the shortest facade on the east or the west side, where the sun heats in 90 degree angles, so it's most intensive. While the north and the south sun, yeah, there's the equator, the north sun, they're treated symmetrically for good reasons, and they can be long because they don't get so much direct light anyway. On the other side, also on the other extreme, we have these isolated houses which are digged into the soil, and they do, of course, they work with mass. Yeah? They do everything to keep the heat inside, to minimize kind of the interface to the climatic outside world, just leaving the window for getting some light in. Also, the strategies we follow in Austria, like having huge glasses on the south side to exploit the massive solar gains, probably in the northern, very far northern winter, not so successful. So, also here, architecture evolved, vernacular architecture, in probably a series of trial and error, but also availability, of course, considerations. The first kind of engineering-like considerations I found is the considerations of Socrates, who described kind of what we call a passive house. Big south facade, but the roof which avoids the summer sun, gets the winter sun deep into the house. Using thermal mass for all the other sides, having a buffer zone to the north, but also increase the cold winds coming from the north. And that's insofar interesting because it also shows a shift in thinking in building. Because this was one man sitting down and thinking what would be the best way to optimize yield with the climatic conditions given, but also in terms of function, yeah? Because this was of course a storage room, the porch can be used in summer nicely and so on. So it's an early example of modern engineering. So it never took off. Yeah, he even gave up the rectangular plan, thinking that I want to maximize this house, but I want to minimize all the other oriented skin elements. It never had much influence. Also, Vitruv took a lot of this consideration over Vitruvius. But in fact, in Middle Europe, other social influences were much stronger, like how you build in a city, how you are allowed to have the front facing the street or not. There were surprising rules in the Middle Ages and so on. Nevertheless, in the 19th century and in the 20th century, we ended up in engineering. We ended up in engineering because we were very fast. We created a lot of problems you never had before, like lighting the floor of a skyscraper. So you need a big glass facade, but if you have a big glass facade, it's overheating. If it's overheating, I need an air conditioning system, and so on. So a lot of problems were also created and more or less solved, and science then also found the reason why we do that, why we do building physics, not only for the energy cost was not an issue. Basically, it's for comfort, that's why we want the building scheme. And so that was wisely enough, they invented this term, thermal comfort, global thermal comfort, local thermal comfort. So you should be familiar with that. So this all the engineering efforts kind of centered around this, and we have two options to achieve that. And I know this story from the forward from the architecture of the well-tempered environment from Rainer Benne, that said it goes back to Vitruv, that the first tribe who did architecture came to in the wood, to a place where it wanted to stay overnight, and it found a pile of wood. The tribe had two options, to make a bonfire, keep itself warm for one night, and having a party. Or to build a house and stay there. And recently, because of we started to understand energy better and better in the 18th, 17th century, 19th century, 18th, 19th century, thermodynamics, we understood that there is something like an irreversibility in all these processes. So, if you burn the wood, you also find out probably. But also with the depleting resources, we now have this idea that we have to keep the energy as good as we can. We have to maintain it, try to not use it, we try to not use it to achieve a most, and that is what we call efficient living. So with least resources, getting out the maximum of comfort. So this is the background where we are now, but we also lost something on the way. And, we lost the party in a way, because it's certainly much more fun to sit around the bonfire than to sit in a cold hut, which is not cheap. Of course, the relatives of changing this effect. But in the thinking now, the energy efficient the debate, it's very much of avoiding the bonfire and making a very well insulated living scheme. And there's another aspect if you want to understand energy. It's also, since actually we know it's very closely related to matter. It's a cousin of matter. Matter is again space, and what we like to argue is that it's not only and the other aspect is that usually we don't have children. We never in contact with package of energy. Rarely, batteries, something like that. We had a nice discussion on the way here, and I found that I was told that speaking was a power plant, and somebody said that it was an energy factory, and it's a nice term, but you couldn't say energy factory because you don't produce pieces of energy. It's a plant, you produce a flow. So it always comes in watt, it always comes in joule per second. And so this energy, this moment of time comes into all we do, all we think. So if you do an energy concept, you always do the concept, we always describe the building in at least four different states, in the state of the summer, the winter, the season between, day and the night. So the time becomes as much a factor as space is. And I also think that we shouldn't give up too early on the idea of building bonfires. This is a super studio vision from the 1960s, which probably was mentioned different, is a different goal, but the description is that this image shows a grid which is covering the world and supplying humankind with everything it needs, so that architecture is not necessary anymore. I read that it was meant as a negative utopia. I think it's a nice utopia that we are just in a grid of possibilities. And also, but we don't see a lot of aspects which we should see there, but are still there. Yeah? So if this is true, if this is a grid which supplies us with all we need, then probably one who sits has a warmer radiation around himself, maybe warm air around himself. There are a lot of aspects of the physical world. We design them, if we want or not. But also this space, in this space we design them. But we don't see them. We underrate what we don't see. And this aspect, we get an opportunity, we get the opportunity to enter for architecture a next dimension. Before we had always these attempts to see architecture as frozen music and just a long kind of trivial narrative. Okay? This is kind of a nice sculpture, trying to translate four measures of Fuchs, of Bach into a sculpture, into a three-dimensional expression. And we see how complex that gets. And it gets so complex because it lacks the dimension of time. So we started to look into what was out there, like buildings which on the one hand, change in time, on the other hand, also taking up that energy challenge of adapting with the energy flows and with the flow adapting in time. This is the oldest radical vision I found in the desert near Palm Springs from Floyd Angelo. He was an airplane engineer and it was still working. It was running on initially, it was said to run on early photovoltaics. And this building in the desert, of course, it goes with the sun, avoiding direct light. So they run it, of course, fast. And it's difficult to see that. But the idea is that these windows never get direct sunlight. And so the building remains cool inside. Another 60s experiment from Simon Connolly and Mark Fisher. That was more interesting, it's not much of a building, but it's much of a principle. How could we transform building schemes, how could we transform elements in time and controlled? That was probably kind of successful consideration. And then we have all that interactive architecture attempts of hyperbody. A research group of Kasselhaus in the Netherlands, who went probably most far in this attempt of designing change, but totally neglecting the energy question. So to bring that together, to bring that idea of, on the one hand, energy conscious concept, yeah, because I think at the university is also important to start with a certain consciousness. If I know the environmental, the climatic elements, if I know user demand, even if I'm not able to maybe immediately solve it in one semester seminar, but I think from the didactic approach that plants in your mind these energy issues, and then you are also posing the right questions, and you're able to work together with the right engineers. You're able to set up your design from the beginning and to kind of encourage the students to follow this idea. We used a very strong metaphor, so we said this is an ecological ballet. So yeah, to make sure you design change, you should design change with the climate, with the usage, but you should design it. Yeah, like a ballet is designed, yeah, like a dance floor, yeah, dance is designed. It's not just technical movement. It's a lines, sun-shading system. We do it nowadays, it's a mere engineering approach. Of course, it works. But if you want to go beyond, and if you want to come to new solutions, then we should rethink how we design. And that's some projects from these exhibitions we will show. Also, Carlo, you said that it's also a new way of representing architecture. It's necessary. Maybe you want to.
Hello. Galo. Yeah, so in terms of these choreographing, you know, we have automatic window shades. And they can be open and closed. But what we're trying to do is to what happens in between? How do you design this moment? Because when you see something moving, it's actually quite captivating. The first time you see a 3D printer working, you stand in front of the thing for like the first half an hour just watching this thing like moving back and forth doing something. So it's a great possibility now to design movement and to choreograph how things go from one stage to the other. So what we try to do is, in a way, me come from an art education for architecture, craftsmanship and making was really strong in the way that I thought and the way that I designed. And looking back in terms of architecture, architects used to be craftsmen. Like in the medieval time, an architect could design a building, but he could also carve a stone, could also make a painting. And so he could actually guide the workers to do exactly what they can, what they could do. And now in this generation of architects being trained with all of these CNC machines, we're exploring again new ways of manufacturing. So it takes us away from using the standard elements, but actually design your own details, design your own objects. And not only that, one thing that we want to do is being involved in all parts of production. So teaching the students some electronics, some mechanics, some coding, and some manufacturing where they can, instead of, I guess we have a couple of sets of works that I will go into and we can explain them a little bit further.
And of course we still teach optimization also, it's not that this is obsolete, also an ongoing optimization is an optimization. But of course it's still in many ways justified, and although I showed that earlier in the semester, I wanted to show that one project once more. It's a competition, we got third prize for it, and it's an attempt to do a glass energy building. And of course, we did that earlier in the office with the school building and other functions, but this is a university extension. But they had a very strong idea of plus energy, and we wanted to support that and even go beyond that. We said we want to deliver with this building not a certain amount of energy, we want to deliver the energy when you need it. Yeah? So that's of course much more difficult than what usually is understood as plus energy building. If you have enough photovoltaic on it, then you have a plus energy building, but you don't have it when you need it in the meantime. And this competition of course also started from a very restricted urban situation. So with the building body, you couldn't do a lot, you couldn't optimize the global building. Because you would have to use all the space. That's a typical problem in any dense city. That of course the site allows for a certain volume, and you want to use that. We try to optimize that a bit, but then we wanted to on that global optimization, a local optimization, where we applied genetic algorithm, applied simple scripting tools like Grasshopper, and in the background we ran an ecotect analysis to kind of get the most sun, but we wanted to get that in the winter time. So that ruled kind of the folding of that facade. And this university was a university for agriculture, yeah, and so biology, agriculture, stuff like that. So we also said it should have something to do with that, and instead of putting just some photovoltaic on the facade, would be only proposed as an alternative. We would have, of course, some on the roof to kind of reach enough electricity demand supply, But on the facade, we wanted to work with organic material. So on the one hand, they should be able to experiment with different plants, also to clean water and so on. And but most of the most efficient phases would be used for a photobioreactor, so for growing algae in the insulation panels. There's a building in Hamburg, engine per arc, so it's not a per se, not a totally new idea to do that. But what was new is how we integrated it into that facade optimization, how we optimized the geometry, and how we integrated it into the whole system so that we can really perform when we need and always keep that building autarch independent. The idea is that we get the biomass from the facade, we cool it down, or in winter we would maybe even have to heat it from time to time. And then taking the heat out. And then there's a moment where you can harvest the algae, you can make gas from that biomass, and then you can store it. That's the nice thing. Because the big problem is in the energy is how do I store energy for electricity usage. Heat is easier to manage. And the nice thing is, if you have gas or oily liquid, what you get out here, you can burn it in a CPU and CHP is called in English, and a combined heat and power unit. And so when it's dark outside, when it's cold outside, you still can burn the algae, and then with that you produce on the one hand electricity and on the other hand heat. And of course then you have all the heat recovery systems and so on. So finally you get a positive balance, but of course we produce much less energy than the Galo 1, because the Galo 1 just produced as much photovoltaics as it could, but it wouldn't produce it in the winter. So is this thoughts in mind, and also it's reaching in the built situation with a lot of restrictions. We go back into our research and teaching department, and we try to structure these attempts. And we found some kind of categories, like having an optimized body and optimized surface. And if it's optimized, then it can also be adaptive. And be optimized in time, then we would call it adaptive. And these strategies were kind of underlying the study projects that follows. And then with the development of these ideas, we also have one project then to show in the end that is readapted. That means that it also can change the logic of adaption. So maybe.
So to implement these things, we first looked at the environment and the user, like how this space is going to use. And what we do is we usually put an object in the environment. This object has two options. It can be a static object or a dynamic object. And we figure we want to concentrate on dynamic objects. And then if you make something dynamic, something that is moving, you again get two options. Presentational, meaning it's pre-programmed. Like we know what time the sun comes today and what time it goes down, what time it's going to come up tomorrow. We know exactly from what angle, so it's pre-programmed to do its thing, and it's moving, it's kinetic, it's just doing what it's supposed to do. Interactive is different. Interactive, you know, the viewer, the audience have something to do with it, and this is the direction we want to go. And then after looking at what we're doing, we realized there were two more options. Something that is interactive adaptive and something that is readaptive. So in the adaptive part, there is the global, something that adapts globally, and somebody in something that adapts locally.
And we adaptive feedback is a nice aspect of also an ephemeral architecture. So getting already close to the studio.
And to follow or try to get to these strategies, we use some processing, Arduino, some softwares, some electronics to be able to test this live. To have a sensor and have our digital model reacting to a live data input or the other way around. And it's really nice what happens when you take analog data, transform it digitally, and then output it back analog. So this kind of translation is kind of like Google Translate. You get an answer that you weren't quite expecting. It's a little bit wrong, but this little bit wrong usually makes it very nice. So this is the cycle we're trying to follow. We start at the top with the environmental data collection. So the way we look, the way we look at things, like what are the inputs we're going to use. Then we go into the intention, which is the artist's or the architect's vision, what do they want to do with this information. Then there's the performance, like what is it that they're going to do. And in this case, performance is not a performance of a building element, but performance in terms of art and music, like how is it going to move, how is it going to interact, how is it going to act. And this performance is exposed back to the environment and the user, which is going to change the way we collect the data again. So these cycles are going to move. In terms of experimenting, the environmental data collection goes through multiple inputs. And these, right now, we can collect all sorts of information, like wind speeds, temperature, CO2 in a room. The intention, the choreographing is the design part, and that is mitigated through digital design or programming. Then the output would be the mechanical element. How do you design the responsive system? And then the performance is being watched by the user, which finishes the cycle. So in this way, going back to the previous diagram, these are a couple of examples of projects that were done in the studio dealing with the global aspect, more of a massive movement, how the whole building reacts.
So that was a study for kind of a pavilion where the building scheme itself would, on the one hand, press, would change to funnel the air to the building, but it also would have different starting points, like less volume in the winter, more volume in the summer. And is this, so it's, of course, it's fragmentary, but is this aspect that could react very clearly to climatic conditions, and especially we were then interested in having this also translated into the model. Because as Carlos said in the you cannot represent it nearly with drawings anymore. And what you see here now is that it has different light sensors, and if you shake that sensor, and you see that it starts to change its behavior. And depending on winter and summer, it either takes the air especially from that spot, because it assumes in winter that this is warmed up by the sun, because there's much light, or the other way around, in summer, it would try to avoid that spot and would take it from a shadowy area. And the nice thing was that there was also a switch for the audience. You could turn from summer to winter mode and you could try it safe.
I think one thing that we realized working at that scale was that just like making a model, you scale the components, you scale the materials to actually show what they're doing. We also have to scale the time. Because if you imagine me being in a building, moving that aggressively, it would be really scary. You want to run out of this thing. So usually you should be moving a lot slower, kind of breathing, creating the flow, but to show it at that scale, you also have to scale the time. And this was kind of a nice notion to figure out how you show a project of such a, doing such a massive movement, but if you see it working in real time, you would have to sit there for 4 hours to see one cycle go through.
Another global transformation was this tower. Student Philip Reisberg, who is his Philip and Philip came back from an excursion to Hong Kong, yeah, and he said, whatever you ask me to do, I want to do a meeting in Hong Kong. Yeah, so yeah, it's okay, but I like the students have their own head. And so we said, okay, then integrated into that idea. And he analyzed the environmental data and he found that the strong humid hot winds in Hong Kong, they come from different directions. And there are but also quite nice tempered and not so wet winds from the land, which would render in a, during a vast period of the year air conditioning not necessary. And so his idea was to have a tower which could, but these winds are very, very mild, they're very slow, yeah, they don't put much pressure on the buildings. And the problem is then how do you get building ventilated, how do you get across ventilation? And that's of course of enlarging the surface area, while the air you don't want to get in anyway, it makes sense to make the surface area smaller. And another aspect here is that of course you also structurally could economize on structure, which is also embodied energy, free energy. It's not so far-fetched. On the one hand, we have at the end of the Danube Tower, which is a revolving restaurant on a tower. So technically, I wouldn't say that's totally far-fetched. And on the other hand, you have all the studies of Schlecht-Bergermann, the Stuttgart Engineering Office, which is into so-called active statics, where they exactly try to minimize breaches and so on with making the bearing react to the loads. So I think from the layout, from the basic design, it is a quite successful concept. And we have only not a real movie of that one, I don't know why. But here you can see how it was designed. As it was ruled by the model was done by a little rotor, and the rotor would tell the building the wind speed. So it was merely reacting on the wind speed, assuming that the strong winds always come from a certain orientation. The mild winds always come from that other orientation. Of course, in real life, it would be different. But it worked nicely.
This is another massive movement project where the house was designed as a living working space that would actually readapt to the way the space can be used better. This was Randall Karaivanov, and actually he was one of Greg Lean's students, so he actually took on the idea of Greg's, what's it,
Ario? House. RV house,
yeah, and actually expanded into quite a bit more. So he made three massive movements. So the house has three axes, and actually would reorient with the sun. So as the house moves, these parts would rotate to use other surfaces that are not usable. So every surface was a walking area, depending on how the house would readapt.
And the nice thing here is that it was very, very deep, as a deep study, and it was not only taking into account the energy, the
question, but also the user question. So, so this adaption could be programmed in a way that either I'm at home, one depending on the climate, host maximum solar gains in the winter, maybe maximum shading in the summer, but even I could overrule that and have a specific view out of the building. But there was also a state of kind of being idle, and then this building would make itself small because the area around the building was covered with photovoltaics to maximize the radiation on the photovoltaics. But it was, anyway, this area for energy production, yeah, so that to avoid too much conflict of the movement with the, also of the optimization for the interior to the energy production. And it was an impressively functioning representation in Grasshopper. It was linked to a climate file that also was very smart in a way that we don't need a sensor then anymore, because we have all we need, we can translate from the environmental data. The idea for all this project was that they linked to our weather station, and he was the only one who managed to do that, and to feed this hourly data into the building. Of course, here also we have an example of a skate time, and to translate that into the energy impact on the interior, the energy impact of the photovoltaics, and then to run these different programs. Here you see how this model was linked, that you would have exactly the same movements in the computer. And the only missing link, actually, I think the whole script you could immediately use. The only thing which misses is the sensor for the interior climate.
And yeah, maybe
another thing is that this is really comes very close to that idea of a ballet, this is really dancing, sculptural dance, and a very designed change. So yeah, this was the idle position. And the next series of models to show is about this other adaption, the local precise adaption, which allows to follow a person. But still, here we can influence an indoor climate, but it's not that precise, it's not local. You can say I follow this climate, a specific person. This fragment of a facade was following that idea, that you have a skin, a proximity sensor where you know where somebody is, you know who it is, and what preferences that user has. And together with this information and together with the climate information, you would then open and close the facade elements.
And one thing of going from the global to the local that was quite interesting was that for the global, we make an architectural model the way we're used to. There's a scale, you make it, you try to represent it as close as possible to show your idea. But when we start designing and making these prototypes, are one-to-one objects. They have to have a real motor, it has to actually move the real material, it has to react real time. If this was implemented in the facade, this would be the speed that it would open and close as the people walk by. So So all of a sudden, we go down in scale, like focus on the detail, but we go up in size in terms of making the object and really designing and figure out, we have to get a motor that is strong enough to make it move. So we're actually making objects and changing the way we think from designing and making a drawing to give somebody else to do, to actually something as a student you have to make on your own because you don't have the resources to jump it out into a factory and say, I need this thing. When it doesn't work, you have to rechange it.
This is a project that what is working with biomass, so thinking up this idea of including algae. And the students were interested in a special kind of algae, growing algae, and they had the idea that they could even contribute to lighting, which is maybe after some genetic modifications also possible. The interesting thing here is that they had to design them not only the device in the room where they want to apply it, which was the room behind the wall, which was dark, but also these organisms need to reload and they need to have a very clear rhythm. So there are two chambers with algae in these elements, and there are kind of two shifts. So one algae population is recovering, reloading kind of in the sun, and one is used in the back. And with I cannot see much here, but there are vibrating elements, also from hand motors, mobile phone motors, and they would know where you are. They would trace your position, and then with vibration activate the lighting. So this algae, they start to light if they hit the waves. That's they know that they should glow. The next project also bad with that.
Arthur?
Nope.
Yeah, also with the help of an Estonian expert.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, Arthur was our student in this project. Mm-hmm. And this was designed to be an air filter. So there would be CO2 sensors that would measure how much CO2 is in the room. And these would activate a series of pumps that would go into these pillows that would inflate, then run the air through the algae. The algae would heat up the CO2 and exhale oxygen. And so not only make a filter, make something that depends on the room or where you would be, it would make the air quality better, but have to design the object, figure out the scale, like how big the pumps would have to be, and deal with the actual manufacturing. With the programming, where does it start? How does the cycle go? So like reading the CO2 level, comparing it, taking an action, opening, closing the valves, and going all the way around.
And this is a clear shift from that application of having it in the facade. We also were worried because it was in November, if you could get enough light in there. But they grew very well in this little light even indoors. And that's kind of interesting to get this new function of really using them as an air filter. That's the difference of the facade algae projects, I would say. And what was also, so here you see that the girl shakes the element and then it stops pressing. And it has a nice sound effect from the labs.
So the success here is especially that it became a great design, not only not only a useful technical device. So the latest outcome of our design research is the following project, which is an application towards city scale. And what is interesting here is that if it comes to that, the elements become smaller and smaller. And also, the adaptive logic must last much longer than with a building, because a building still is very, it's better to foresee what a building will be, how it will change, how long it will use. A city should live forever. And so the adaptive logic must be really adaptive. You must be able to reprogram from scratch. And this is what Ike Shandor did with this urban modification project. And in this semester, we were investigating potential of the most dense district in Vienna, how to densify them even more. Background is that in Vienna we have, it's a growing city, we have 20,000 new inhabitants per year, and this growth is predicted to continue the next 15 years. And of course, from a sustainability point of view, it makes much sense to try to build additional living space where there is already infrastructure, where there is already there are already streets, people. And the idea of that project now is
So one of the nice things about getting to this point is how to design local elements that can be applied globally. So how these small elements can actually start influencing a city, city behavior, city spaces. And we'll see where this research is going to take us.
You're far from being done.
I just have to go. So the densification strategy here is what we do in Vienna a lot is extending on the top. And because, of course, you have to, the roofs are free, it's very nice also to have a look over the city. I'm finished in 5 minutes. But that is more or less done, yeah? But it adds kind of 10-15% of the existing living area. What we wanted to achieve is less privileged situations like the ground floor, which doesn't get much sun, like the courtyards. How can we gain them? How can we win them for residential, for apartment usage? At the moment, you usually use it for shopping or as a depot. Here, the idea is that by redirecting light into these areas, you make them more sleeping there. So, stories, windows that never got light before, is these devices, the flippers, I mean, get direct radiation now. They can be protected from visibility from view, so they can also produce visibility, intimacy. even to be able to a certain extent create a sound protection. The idea is that a flock of drones is going over the city and can be ordered also by the inhabitants of the city, and that these drones reflect light, bring energy to the place where it's needed most. And here we the next move we see the life of such a debris. So this is such a drone element, a quadrocopter. They, of course, like all robotic devices, usually will, but this one just died by accident, but they find a place where they can recharge using solar energy.
In 2052, on a cold
hour, and we look back into that life of the big drone. So here it's not only about energy, you can even bring back ornament to facades which lost them in the 1960s.
As a detecting strain approaching from the east, a flock on the opposite side starts to stretch along the facade in order to protect from sound pollution. 27.5% of Viennese residential facades are facing north. Each morning,
like the
are synchronized usage. To alarm clock.
There's a little village in Tyrol that never got sunlight. They did such a project with a static mirror.
There's
a flock of mirrors which should work quite brilliant. Another idea is that they can provide or can improve microclimate on the street, on places, and then there's a free now use space for new residential space. You can see the urban
flock.
Lights
millions of windows and performs in hundreds of advertisements. Fire makes use in office buildings turning to residential.
Demand analysis.
City starts to fluctuate on a database. 2 years later, on the 8th of June, Hebrew is performing with Flock 27 in Bruno Kreisky Park. They've been practicing with the acoustic show for the last 2 weeks. With the control of the bomb of acoustics, Libris are mixing the sound of the part together with the sound of the instrument. After the morning concert, Libris needs charging along the river. Suddenly, it records a last-minute order from the inner courtyard of the neighboring building. Libris flies above the courtyard. The cafe canopies are just about to merge with the
end.
Sensing radius decreases.
Libris needs enough power anymore.
Flat back, turns on human avoidance, and drops into a funeral
home. Coffee mug. What is fascinating about that is that an architecture really dissolves here. And Vicky Sander, the student, she also said she's a curator. So she's choosing events with the movement. But the steel perform architectural tasks, the steel perform space and energy.
So instead of designing geometry, as most architects or as most of us do, we can start designing events. So something has a beginning and an end, and again, going back to the image of architecture being a symphony frozen in time, maybe architecture doesn't have to be frozen anymore.
Thank you.
It's time for questions.
Now, if I can start, there's an immense sort of array of technological improvement which is included in the sort of the whole design process. And so the simple question in the background there is how close do you see the building industry to that? Actually, we're building in the academia the sort of one-to-one prototypes of all sorts of very interesting things. Is there anything sort of close to being able to being actually sort of be applied by the industry?
Well, different, like the project center. There is less in the building industry, but technology, of course, provides everything we showed is technologically possible. Building industry, we have this experimental building in Hamburg, for instance, with the Archive Facade. We have a lot of, we also work together with Martin, but light designer, where we use daylight redirections, not new. It's been applied since 15 years. Of course, the most radical vision that the drone project we showed last is not what we would do overnight, and there would be also a lot of legal issues, yeah, which is, I think, much more the problem we face in developing architecture.
Yeah, but I think in terms of this generation of architects are being trained in a way that you have access to so many production processes already at school that you're free to use and experiment with. It's really easy for a young architect to go to a fabricator and tell them, look, I know you have these machines and you can make this for me, even if they have never used the tools that you use. So I think there is a lot of chance that if you design it properly and you know how it should be made, you can actually tell somebody that has the craftsmanship to do what you need to be done.
I'm wondering about, do you also do research on the psychological aspect of adaptive buildings in the sense that for many people, buildings are kind of expected to be safe and stable and solid and so on, and if that building starts moving, they might lose the trust in the building or being there, you know, partly. Or about the expectation about how reliable the mechanisms are. So.
Yeah, we don't do studies in psychology. But Galo mentioned that most of the models we showed scaled in time. Also, there is way faster adaption that we propose with these projects than usual building would adapt to. Or maybe a more visible adaption. It's not that it would be like in the examples shown. Also, a lot of adaption is happening already, like blind shutting, and a lot of machinery adapts all the time, so it's not so far-fetched. You're right in terms of stability. We have this problem like in the Applied Arts University, there is a roof extension done by a colleague of us. There is a glass floor. And a lot of people don't walk on that. Yeah? Also, there's no difference between a glass floor and a concrete floor. The one is, you see what is underneath, and the other one, you won't see what is underneath.
maybe, depending on how it's calculated, that would be a problem. Maybe it's less redundant. That's an issue with structure design. As if this column starts to break, you would know in advance. That it's super lightweight. Construction breaks, it breaks immediately. So these things, of course, would have to be considered. If we, in our design research experiments, already should take into it, I think if we would start like that, we wouldn't find anything new. I think if we would start to consider the resistance, which is always coming this thing. But our exhibitions, maybe that's one aspect. We always try to float public. And the exhibitions, which are well visited and not only by academia, we had very positive feedback. People are fascinated. I agree that this is an aspect, but I don't think it's not our biggest problem.
I think it's an aspect that, as designers, we consider all the time. I don't think there's a... When you design a kinetic building, you design the movement. And it's no more different than when you design a house, you design the door, and then you design the foyer, which leads you into the living room. So you're designing the way you walk through the space. You also design the movement to be inviting. So it's pretty much a one-to-one comparison. When you design a kinetic building or a kinetic object, you have to design how it moves, at what speed does it move, how does it invite you, how does it tell you a story, and it's no more different than drawing a plan or designing a plan for a house.
It seems like the only constant in all the good kind of projects and research is specific climate. I just wanted to ask if there's anything really interests you in Estonian climate. Because there's always a weather file that's unique to a place. So basically every place in the planet is almost unique. But is there something that you're kind of really excited about Estonian climate? If you kind of want to test that.
Yeah, definitely. The questions a lot of passive concepts. It's not so available. And of course, when preparing the seminar, we looked into that data. Also, rethinking and re-questioning the concepts, discussing them. But it's not true that we always run in the same file. the idea of adaption is. One of these courses was called Any Climate. So it was also very much about, is there a building which could answer any climate, which is also possible. The question is if it's worth doing it. And especially at this time, narrative is aimed at questioning the optimization, as we showed in the beginning. We don't even know in the very location if the climate will remain. And even without CO2, we wouldn't know it. Yeah, because all has changed. Yeah? Now we also change it. Yeah? And we seem to know that it's going in a certain direction, but what the climate does locally, nobody knows. Globally, there's one. But that doesn't mean that it's locally. So that was the second slide. So it's probably not so smart to optimize towards a very specific. Also, it's very fascinating, I have to admit. But it's probably the wrong way to do
it. Any more questions? It's very clear, or it's too difficult.
I will have a simple question. Thank you for your lecture. Knowing your background, that you're educated as an architect and artist, and now occupying the field of engineering. How your background helps you at the moment in the world where is the first, it's a term is optimization.
What was the last in the term
of optimization?
Mm-hmm. I would say, as a, for me as an architect, Carlo has said, if there is a studium generale in that thing, if there's a general study, then it's architecture. I think that's what makes so fascinating. And that is what helps most, as it allows to have a different view on the tasks, on the questions, on the problems. And it also allows to connect different fields of knowledge much better, I think. It allows in the communication with all the experts to be more sound. But I certainly miss, I really regret that I didn't also study physics. I would really love to understand physics much more fundamentally. But now it's but I try to keep up to date and so on. But it's really something if you didn't study that from the beginning, which it sometimes if you go really deep into some questions, you miss, and then okay, you have other experts and you team up. But yeah. Without architecture, we couldn't work like that. We have a lot of happy clients. So I think it was at least for some people a decision.
Yeah, I guess for me the best thing is the fact that I'm not an engineer. Because you can come up with ideas that might not be the most efficient and most optimized, but hopefully they're a little bit more poetic.
Good point.
I can ask one more. This is about the dynamics of that, or more like the scale of the kinetics that you use. Most of the projects you show this kind of, even if the shape of the whole building changes, each local element is kind of still actuated quite locally. I'm curious, have you done any kind of conceptual research or visionary projects also with more kind of more modular buildings that not just the models are not moving locally, but they are moved off-site maybe for season or rearranging totally themselves or something like that?
So buildings that are moving themselves, or
but not as a whole, but kind of modules coming off and on and being like more.
And that was most the last one we showed with the drones flopping around. We had an investigation into moving architecture. It's for a research station. It was a nice project, actually. So actually, here, it's already, we still want to be very close to what can happen. Yeah? And for instance, in this semester, when we investigated the densification of Vienna, one project was also changing the city fabric in a way that he questioned that if you have self-guided electric cars, if you have sharing options for apartments on, then these clear borders on what a site is, what a building can dissolve, and then you get a different fabric which might serve better, also energetically, because the Viennese grid, for instance, is energetically very good. This is already on the border, but it's not totally unlikely. But as I said before, I think the biggest issue in the evolution, and also a serious one, also with the drone watching, for instance, there's a lot of things you would also have to consider, privacy, legal things, accidents, and so on. Yeah? And if you start to have buildings wandering around, like the walking cities of Africa, then this is really a different world, which is maybe not even something we want to reach.
I think he meant that buildings what can be moved, not moving by themselves.
Okay.
And
like
then
a train,
and also that
like a trailer home.
Yeah, it's like, yeah, like, and the blocks what you can combine.
A modular system,
yeah,
which you can, like a upcycling or recycling strategy. I mean, there has been a lot of experience in the 80s, 90s with this container elements reconfiguring. It's not so interesting, but more for us. Yeah. Not that I wouldn't say it's not interesting, but for us it's a bit. We like to design, and of course you can design within a very strict grid. I don't know why you can do that. Maybe you should.
No, I think the way when we design the tasks for doing research or to teach for a semester, what we try to do is to set up a scenario that it's in the near future, but like not science fiction, not something completely undoable, but kind of something that would become an attractor. So hopefully...
But this was a misunderstanding. It's the science fiction.
Yeah, no, that's not a problem. So, like, if we do something in the near future, and like something that we can justify in a plausible way, that you can imagine these things actually working, maybe it becomes an attractor for other people to start designing or going the same direction.
Not anymore. The answer. because it's a good question. And of course, it would be great reconfiguring buildings quickly. You don't need it there anymore, you take it away. There is also a nice dissertation in the TU Delft. It's just a nice title of time-based architecture. So I read it. And this was, for me, a bit aesthetically disappointing about reconfiguring elements. And what the woman proposed was that we should design elements of a building scheme, of a wall, in a way that, like, now we have maybe some conducts for air, for electricity, some cables running in there, and all that has to be removed, and so on and so on, and it makes it more or less impossible. And she very seriously filleted the building into all these elements, also looking into what is the lifespan of these different elements, and then put a system together where she posed that if we all would have our electricity cables here and our contact there and our canal, then that would be a great thing, because then it would take out the element and reconfigure it. And that reminded me then on the metabolistic architecture of the early 1970s, where they also had actually great ideas of this growing and repeating certain patterns. And their experience showed that was never used. Because the moment you design it, it's old. The moment you build it, you produce it, it's gone. Nobody's interested. Sometimes, unfortunately, like the UNO city in Vienna, which is a fantastic metabolistic zone. And Staber, the architect, wanted, of course, that if there are additional buildings, then you should continue growing that structure. Of course, 30 years later, they built some stupid towers. Yeah, so, unfortunately. But it's not, and they destroyed the sky and everything, which has been very good to follow that. But the experience shows that this is not, you don't even have the people in power anymore. You have to use the system. Not that it's a bad idea, but I think it's an idea which is hard to realize in a, at least in a free democracy and so on, where you can't force people too much. Which is a good luck.
I have one more, a slightly didactic question perhaps. How much of your research can you involve in your teaching, or then how much can you take from the teaching to the research?
It's very blurred. It's depending on the topic. Last time I was here, I showed you this research on energy certificates. This is not sexy. You cannot do that. Not much. But it doesn't lead to anywhere. But in the real world, it's the whole service. You have to research the effect and of that. Also, we investigated the parameters and the sources of error in these certificates. And if you look at that, then you see how that falsifies. How this gives a wrong impression on what we are actually. But to come back to the question is, I couldn't work without the university, because I need this side where I can talk to interesting, ambitious young people, and it is keeping up, I think, creativity and the spirit, and also, of course, there are a lot of ideas which we can then rethink in real buildings. And the other way around is as much important. If I would teach only, I would lose the ground. This is with architecture. I mean, you know also. This with architecture, I think, really an issue. As if you don't. You very quickly, I think, detach yourself from what is going on out there. And that's a bit what I think is still in all these projects. There's still, like we want students to design this energy in mind or future architects. And I have also, on the other hand, some, there's not only it's not all only bad things about rules, authorities, and standards, and I also have this in mind when I'm teaching. So I think this is going forth and back. And the recent research commission we got from the Austrian Research Agency last week, that's evaluating what we did with the students. And of course, this evaluation will then go back to the students. So the students will even be involved.
How the students are involved in research.
Yeah, I mean,
we're doing in February.
We get to build some pavilions. There's some research among the students, and I don't know. It's a great place to steal ideas. You test the ideas with the students. You see what they do. Hopefully they make something better than you thought it was going to happen, and then
I have to say it's not one way.
For sure.
To implement to implement ideas is as much important.
He's asking what we
did. No, but that's an important point, because I was asked if this lecture is about to be taped. I think everything we do, I mean, we are funded by the state. I mean, everything we do is public. There is no stealing ideas for neither of us. Not our ideas can be stolen the other way around, because science has to be done.
Okay, any more questions? Not really. In this case, thank you very much again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
like the main thing